Hello and welcome back. We have been discussing how we can set up Mac to run Appium in the real iOS device, because Mac is compatible with both iOS and Android. So in this video specifically, we're going to try and get answer for 5 questions again. So number one question, how to build a real-time iOS application in Xcode. Xcode is an IDE. And second question, when building in the app, what are the different possible errors that somebody can get and what are the troubleshooting options? Third will be where to find the application or IPA file after the build is succeeded. Fourth question, what are the desired capabilities for iOS device? We have seen what are the desired capabilities for Android. What are those for iOS? Number five will be how to invoke the app from application from the Appium desktop client. Let's get started with the number one question, how to build the real-time application. So I've done a bit of research to find out where are the real-time application. I'll show you what are those really. Free open source iOS apps. And the one thing that you're going to get it from the Wikipedia, that they said that there are different list of free and open source iOS applications available. So based on my analysis and try to build an application, I found that the VLC for iOS is working fine, because certain application is not working because of due to some dependency issues or maybe some of the permission issues. But I've found out the VLC for iOS is working fine. So to get the source code of this VLC player, if you click on the Git repository, this is their application, right? So this is the real-time app. So all that you find here is different types of dependencies, and they also given certain instruction how we can start with it for building an iOS app. And beginner's guide, for example, if you find any errors, what are the possible outcome, what are the possible troubleshooting option you can think of, all of these are available. So how to get started with this VLC app? How do we build this app into the Xcode? Let me open the Xcode. I've already set this VLC, as you can see it here. But in case if you wanted to start from scratch, you need to click on the third option, which is nothing but clone an existing project, because this project is already there in GitHub, freely available. You need to go and click on the clone an existing project. So the moment you click, you are prompted to give the URL of this, the Git repository. Where do you get the URL? So click the clone or download button. You can copy this by clicking this icon. Once you copy this one, go to Xcode and copy paste the same thing. And the moment you click on clone, it'll clone all of these files into your local folder. You can choose whichever folder you want. Once you're done, and this folder, this project will be cloned and will be available to the Xcode. Because I've already done, I'll straight away open and show it to you how it'll look like. So this is how it will look like. In my previous video, we have seen how the simulator target can be set. And this is the app. So VLC iOS app. I'm trying to build it on iOS 8 plus, right? As you can see, there are a lot of simulators available. Based on the requirement, you can choose which one you are intending to do. My interest is to go with iPhone 8 plus, right? So this is by default will be given, and you can see here, you can see different targets. So target VLC iOS, VLC TV OS, VLC iOS UI test. So these are the different targets you can build on. But we are interested in only this one. And the moment you click here on the general tab, you will be seeing, you may be seeing some errors. For example, if you are not an authorized person, it may give some error. And if you have an iOS, definitely you will have a basic login. So you just log in with your ID and then keep this ID for your reference, a signing mechanism. But in real time deploying to the iOS app store, you need to have a team ID, which will be your corporate ID, your company ID, where you are licensed to deploy that app into the entire world. So when the moment you upload into the app store, that will become available to everybody. And again, the iOS policy is that you need to have a developer access, right? So you can be a developer as long as you have a valid ID to your iOS store. So I've given mine, and you can also give yours, but it is not a mandatory thing for building a debugging application. And so this is where it looks like, right? So our objective here is to build the VLC app into iPhone 8 Plus. That's an objective, right? So by default, everything will be populated, as you can see here. And the moment you try to run this, click the play button, this run button, you will see that build succeeded. And that means that it will also open up the simulator, right? And it will try to install the application and you will be seeing that application. And you may ask me, is it that straightforward that the moment you click on this run button will get the application installed? No. Initially, you may be facing a few challenges. One challenge specifically I have faced here is to you will get an error like this. I'll show you the error message. You will get an error like this, VLC error, the pod lock or no such file or directory, and no such file directory for manifest or lock, and sandbox is not synced with pod file lock. So how do we rectify this error? So if you go back to Google, the place where we download the application, so they have given a beginner guide. So they have specifically called out, in case if you get such error, what do you need to do? If you go to the beginner's guide and then click this button. So they have given possible errors and solution. So if you, for example, if you get this error, this is what the error I've got. And they say that by following the simple 4-step process, you will be able to rectify that. What is the number one process? Number one step, open up your favorite terminal. It could be your terminal or item 2, whatever. And go to the path where the project has been deployed. In my case, if I go terminal, ls-a will list all the folder, and it is in my documents. So here is my folder vlc.io, that's where I've installed it. And you need to go here specifically and then cd again, put vlc. So you are into the directory now, and then make sure that the cocoa pods is installed. So this is nothing but the dependency manager for iOS specific application, cocoa pods, right? So you need to install it. Just provide this command, sudo gem install cocoa pods. It will take a while, definitely it will take more than few minutes. I would say more than 15 minutes it took for me, and that will get, you know, give you this option. And once it is done, and you need to provide, you need to be in the same path and then put that pod install. So once you are able to done, then you will be done. But the last comment, the step number 4, will take maybe hours. You need to have a patient to get it installed. Every time, this is the first time you'll be doing it. And once you are done, and now you can go back and then go to the Xcode, do the same thing again. So click on this run button or the build button. Once you are done, you will be able to get your application installed. So that means that from here you will be able to, I'll close it again and then let's try to run it later. So from here you will be able to run this application, right? I'm trying to build this again. And the good part about iPhone, as I told you before, this is giving us the device name. That's nothing but iPhone 8 Plus, and the version is 12.1. So this is what we are interested in. So once we are able to launch the application to the iPhone, then from there we need to identify the locator and then do our application automation, right? Okay, so I think we covered the part one of it, right? How to build a real-time application, and when building the application, what are the possible outcome? Again, one other thing to point out is that by default, Xcode may not have this location option enabled. So where do you confirm? Go to Xcode and then preferences. And if you go here in the locations, and by default, the command line tools will be blank. You need to go and select the whichever version of the Xcode that you have installed. You need to go and select it. So I'm assuming that you will have Xcode more than 9, version 9. So that is what it is compatible with most of the dependencies and different devices. If not, then you need to upgrade it to version 10.1 or anything latest. That's where you are finding it. So if you are able to do this, you will not get that location kind of error, right? So that's other thing. Again, Carthage is missing is something when we actually run it through the Appium desktop, then we're going to see that actually, right? So let me park this aside now, and then let's move on to the question number 3. Where do we find the application or IPA file after the build is succeeded? So in our case, that we were able to successfully get that application installed into our application, but where is my application, where is my IPA file, so that I can be able to locate that IPA file and then automate that. So the easiest way you can think of is go to Xcode again, preferences, and if you go to locations, the place where we were before, and here is what it is. So derived data is where the actual IPA or application file will be located. So it's in my directory, home directory, and then library, developer, Xcode, derived data. If I try to navigate to my folder, going to Finder, and then I'm already there. I'm trying to show you that where how can you locate it. So if you go to your home folder, and again you will not able to see that library folder by default. You need to provide a shortcut, command, shift, and then dot. If you put it back, you will get that all the hidden files, hidden folder as well. Click on this library, and you will see after the Android, you will see developer. So this is where the built application is lying. Where is that? If you go to developer and Xcode, derived data, and here are different applications I've built and tried before. Nothing worked. The one thing that worked is the VLC one. So VLC one, click on it. And if you go to build and products, debug iPhone simulator, and this is where the application is. So the way we similarly, if you remember it, the way we connected an APK file to Android, similarly, we need to locate this file so that Appium can understand where my executable file is, where the IPA file is. This is the file which ends with the APP application. This is where you need to point it. So you know how to get the location of this. Right click on it and get info. This will give you the location ID. So, and you need to append this with your actual file name. Right, so this is a way, this is where you need to you can find your debugging option. But in real-time project, you may not get only the debug option. For example, if you are trying to release the product to the entire world, that means that app store, you will find a release folder here as well, or you may find a test folder. So depending on your type of target or type of release, you will see the different folders. But the one that is interesting for us for now for testing is the debugging one, right? Hope this is clear, and again we are good with the question number 3. Right, where to find the application or IPA file after the build is succeeded. Fourth point, what are the desired capabilities of iOS? Again, I want to take you back to the desired capabilities we have seen for Android, Google, and Appium desired capabilities. Go to the site from desired capabilities Appium. So it's pretty much the same desired capabilities. Platform name is the common. We need to, instead of Android, we should give iOS. Platform version, that the version that we have seen, I think 12.1. Device name, instead of the phone device, we need to provide the simulator name, whatever we have seen. Automation name, XUI test, or you can leave it blank, this is optional. And app, so this is where we will be specifying the path of the application file. So there are specific to iOS as well, but we can, that will help you in the advanced mode of testing where you need to be providing application specific desired capabilities. For now, those will be fine, but I just want to note it down one important point. When you do a real-time application testing in iOS device, you need a UDID, right? So that, and you need also need a bundle ID. So these are the additional two things you should remember when you try to do for a real iOS device. Let's go back and then try to see whether we are able to connect the actual application from the Appium desktop server. I think that's our question number 5, I guess. Let me go back. Yes, how to invoke an application from the Appium desktop client. So we have seen the desired capabilities. If I go and get Appium, so the server will automatically be launched. And by default, we know that this will start from 4723. But in real time, if you are running it for iOS and Android, keep it one for iOS, keep it another for Android. You can change this to, let's say, 4723 is for Android or 4725 for iOS, whatever. So I'm just changing it now. It don't need to be. So click the moment port number is Appium is listening now. And let's confirm that this is also running. Right? And where are we specifying the desired capability? So if you click on the start inspector session, the first button, and this is where we'll be specifying. The way we have done it for Android, same thing for iOS. I've done it already. I'm just showing it to you just for your convenience. So platform name iOS, device name iPhone 8 Plus, where you can see that? You can see that here. The one I'm highlighting here, iPhone 8 Plus 12.1, right? So, and the application path, where the path is, the path I showed you, right? This is the path where the application is there. So the application that ends with application, APP. And platform version. So the version is 12.1. This is where the platform. So with that four desired capabilities, we will be able to invoke the application into the iOS simulator, right? Same thing true for real device as well. There are little more additional desired capabilities that we need to add, like the way I said, UDID you need to add, and maybe your the release version, I guess, right? Yes, so these are the additional thing you can add, and let me try to run this now. Start session. This expectation is that it will get started and you will be able to invoke the application in this simulator. You can see that the installation is happening and you can the VLC is getting installed, and you also see that there is a web driver agent, right? Again, you can ask me, is it that straightforward that you can run it in the first time itself? The answer is no. If you do not have installed the Carthage for WebDriver, you will get an error. So Carthage is nothing but it is the WebDriver agent built by Facebook for automating any of the iOS device. So this will clearly throw an error saying like this. I will show you the error that you will get in the Appium console. You will get error like this. An unknown server-side error occurred. If you read continuously, you will find lines similar to this. Carthage binary is not found. Install using brew install Carthage. So if you have brew installed already, you can just go and install it. If you do not have, just put a sudo brew install Carthage from the terminal. That will get installed automatically, right? So once you are able to get the Carthage, then that means that whatever you are seeing it here, the web driver agent, this folder, this guy, will be installed automatically. So this is an agent which communicates internally within the app to your actual application. Once you're able to done it, then you will be able to invoke the real application into the simulator. So from here, as we know that how we can locate the element, there are different strategies I've discussed already in my previous video, and you need to go and locate it. For example, if you are interested in clicking or searching something, you need to find out specific element and you need to go and find out, right? These are the different possible options you can think of. And once we know that how we can locate an element and iterate it through, then our automation begins there. Hope I covered all of the objective of this session today. Yes, I've covered it. Yes, so from here we need to go from here and then try to do the automation for both iOS as well as Android. And before we go, I think I'm trying to put an video for differentiating different types of applications so that you will get a clarity of what application you are automating, so that you'll be able to easily understand it. I think that's pretty much it. Thanks for watching.